I want to welcome Alessandro Minocci from eCentria. eCentria is a fascinating business. It straddles the world of mostly e-commerce with some brick and mortar. So Alessandro is the Director of Customer Acquisition and Retention, and he's going to be talking to us today about the value of bringing that data into your Google Analytics so that you can make that $55,000 per employee. So Alessandro, I will turn it over to you.
Pat, thank you very much. I'm really appreciative to have the opportunity to speak today at this summit and be part of such an impressive roster of speakers and presenters. So as we get into this presentation today, I'm really excited to tell the a little bit about how we have taken different data systems, brought them together, and what that has meant for our business. So as we get into the presentation here, once again, my name is Alessandro Minocci. I am the Director of Customer Acquisition and Customer Retention at eCentria. I will introduce many of you to eCentria in the next slide. And as I mentioned, today we're going to talk about bringing data systems together with Google Analytics. So a little bit about eCentria. eCentria was founded in the year 2000, right at the point of the dot-com bust. So there were a lot of really well-capitalized companies that started in the late 90s in e-commerce that failed, and there was a bit of a pullback from e-commerce. But our co-founders believed that with the right products, e-commerce was a huge opportunity. And so we started in the year 2000 with our flagship store, opticsplanet.com, selling technical products, microscopes, spotting scopes, and telescopes. Today, Optics Planet offers over 500 categories, with about 4,000 different brands and over a million unique products sold. We are a top 150 internet retailer as part of the old IR500 or the Digital Commerce 360 top 500 now. We're excited to see how we rank after a great 2020 for us. And we are purveyors of gear. So our flagship store is opticsplanet.com. We also have a very popular store, campsaver.com, that serves the outdoor community, camping, hiking, climbing, these sorts of activities. We also have a members-only flash sale store. They still exist. Devor was started in 2010 at the peak of the members-only phenomenon. It is still going strong today. There are new events launching every day, and I encourage all of you to join. Our retail is almost completely pure play e-commerce. As Pat mentioned, we do have a brick and mortar outfit. There is a store for Camp Saver located in Nibley, Utah. It is a showroom store. There is some product that is presented there, but there are kiosks. Individuals can browse our entire catalog, and since it's connected to our distribution center, they can the team can go back, grab the products, they can try them on, check them out, et cetera. We span the globe. So we have locations, two in Illinois, offices in Northbrook, a distribution center in Aurora. We have offices and distribution center in Nibley and Logan, Utah. We have an office in Riga, Latvia, and another office in Odessa. On the next slide, I'll talk a little bit more about what we do. So we are the purveyors of gear for those who play, work, and serve with passion. That is our mission at eCentria and really the guiding principle that we operate on. On the next slide, as we talk about how we do it. So one of the things that is really core to who we are is that we offer selection. So in a traditional big box retailer, or even a specialty store, if you were looking for binoculars, they may have 10, maybe 25 options at a really specialty store across 3 to 5 brands. If you come to opticsplanet.com, you will find about 1,200 different options across 75 different brands. So we go kind of to the ends of the earth to find all of the products within a given category that our customers may be looking for, that they need to fit their needs. And we look to outfit customers from head to toe for all of their passions and professions. We predominantly acquire our traffic, our customers, through digital traffic channels. So we're very reliant on tools like Google Analytics to understand the efficacy of what we're doing. We're always looking to match passionate customers with high performance gear. So looking to use those traffic channels, looking to use our catalog to bring in the right people. And this is really going to transition well into what we're going to talk about today. We accept orders through two primary methods. One is through our website, And the other is what we term as manually, a manual entry by one of our sales team reps. So individuals can call us or use live chat to place an order. So on the next slide, we're going to talk about the problem that we're going to get into today. So if we go on to the next slide, the problem is, what happens if a customer places an order through an offline or a manual channel? So as I mentioned before, we're very reliant on acquiring traffic, acquiring customers through our digital channels. And we rely on Google Analytics to analyze the performance of that and do better all the time. So if the transaction ultimately takes place in a different system and it's not connected, how do we know where they came from? How do we know what campaign brought us this customer and brought us this transaction? How do we know what they looked at? Ultimately, we do know what they bought, right? We have other reporting systems for that sort of thing, but how do we know what options they encountered on our website? How do we know how they eventually got to the product that they picked? And how do we know what features aided in their conversion path? Did they use search? Did they compare products? Did they utilize a wish list? Did they use a deal alert? You know, all of these things that we invest in and work to improve at all times, you know, that information is ultimately missing. So if you go on to the next slide, we can talk about where we kind of started from. So, you know, when you don't have the data, as Neil mentioned earlier, right, you have to use your intuition, you have to use your gut. So the base assumption you might use for these types of customers is, well, they're probably just the same as the type of people that order online. Now, you sit with that for a second and you realize, like, that doesn't completely check out. And I'm going to give you a great example on the next slide. So across our catalog of over 1 million products, there are some differences. So on the left, we have an industrial security camera that we sell. It is a thermal camera, so it's heat signatures and everything like that. It can record, it can stream, it can synchronize. It is super, super cool, and it is $33,000. And on the right, we have one of our top-selling items, a 10x42 binocular. If you are a bird watcher, if you are a hunter, if you are an outdoor lover, you might even have this pair of binoculars. It's such a great seller, and it is $189. Which of these two products do you think is more likely to be sold over the phone with a customer calling and reaching out to one of our sales reps? I can't see the chat. I assume you're all answering, and if you said the left, you're right. You are correct. So if we go on to the next slide, we have to kind of play a little further and create more assumptions once again, because we don't necessarily have the data, but you know, we can draw some conclusions. So they're the same, except they tend to buy more expensive items this way. So what does that really mean? Well, if you have a campaign, a marketing campaign that is focusing on a high value item, then if you have lower performance than you'd like to see, it's probably just because more people are calling in to place those orders and they're just not connecting back. So therefore, it's okay, right? The danger of assumptions should be pretty clear here. So how are we going to solve this? Let's get into the next couple slides and we'll talk about that. Measurement protocol. So if you are not familiar with measurement protocol, there are a lot of great resources out there that explain what it is, but I will give you a brief overview of what it is. It is a framework to send data back into GA. So we're all familiar with how we have tags on our sites and Google Analytics is collecting data and building all those great reports that we can rely on. But there is the measurement protocol, which allows you to send data that is not collected through your website back to Google Analytics. That data then can be connected to specific visitors. So how did we end up utilizing this? So our infrastructure, it's probably a little different from the infrastructure that many of you deal with. eCentria is a technology company through and through. We've got over 100 engineers across the globe working on a daily basis to create new features, improve existing features, maintain and improve our platform. And a lot of the components of our platform are completely proprietary. So that meant we needed to create a custom solution. Our engineering team had to be heavily involved. The key components that were involved in this were our shopping cart, our order manager, and our CRM. I've included a list of other components that are unrelated that are all proprietary too, just to show you how core this is to our DNA. So on the next slide, we can talk about kind of the game plan for this. So we worked with InfoTrust on this, and I'll describe InfoTrust's role in the next slide, but we decided that the right way to do this would be to add a new value to the website called the web client ID. We would then update our order manager where the transaction is being collected, and processes, operational processes, to make sure that we can accept that value at the time of order placement. It's in the order manager and not the CRM, because ultimately we're syncing back transactions. We're not syncing back customer data, we're syncing back transaction level data. And then we would use that value and the GA client ID, which is the value created by Google Analytics, to synchronize that transaction data back to Google Analytics via the measurement protocol. On the next slide, I'll share a little bit about, the on-site implementation. Yes, so here's what it looks like. It might be a little tough to see. I should have used a brighter screenshot, but on the footer of our website, we added a link towards the bottom that says Show Web ID. It's in a conspicuous spot because the majority of customers have no reason to use it. But if you do click that, it gives you a 12-digit number that you can then give to one of our reps. And as I mentioned before, they can enter it into the order manager and everything connects so beautifully. On the next slide, we can talk about the InfoTrust support. So InfoTrust was heavily involved in the beginning parts with the planning and creating very detailed documentation for our development team on what they needed to be sending to GA, the format of sending it, the values that need to be sent it, how to connect back to the specific client ID, and so on. Our engineering team obviously had to build all of the actual code in order to make this happen, in order to send the information to Google Analytics, but the InfoTrust team was very instrumental in making sure that we did it right, that we were sending the right values, that ultimately we didn't corrupt any data. They also helped develop a testing plan that made sure we did exactly that. We did not impact our data negatively. We made sure that everything was working properly before we kind of released it into the wild, right? And then once everything was completed, helped us generate some insights too, which I'll talk about on later slides. So if we proceed to the next slide, this is the workflow of kind of how this worked. So a customer would call us to place an order. The rep would collect the web ID from that customer. The rep would enter the web ID into the order manager. The order was then placed as normal, right? Transaction was completed. A daily job would aggregate all of the orders that were placed manually over the phone, live chat, et cetera, manually into our order manager. The web IDs that were collected would then be matched to GA client IDs. Those orders would then be synchronized back into Google Analytics, and then Google Analytics would link the order back to the specific users using the client ID. So on the next slide, we'll talk a little bit about the insights of value. Actually, you can continue to the next slide too. So we learned quite a few things from this. So I didn't mention all the assumptions we had at the beginning, but some of them turned out to be faulty, as you might expect, and some of them were right on. So one of the assumptions we had was that because those manual orders tended to have a higher order value on average than orders placed over the website, that it was more likely that those customers were being acquired and those transactions were being acquired through paid channels, paid search specifically. And the reason for that is that paid search as a channel tends to have a higher average order value for us than organic search. What we actually found out once we had the actual data was that no, it turns out many of them are being acquired through organic search, much more so than on average for customers that place orders through our website. They're also significantly more likely to visit on desktop than mobile. So once again, this challenges another assumption that we had that was kind of core to beliefs within the sales organization. And that's that one of the reasons why customers call us or chat with us to place an order, as opposed to placing on the website, is that there's more friction that they're dealing with. And typically, you know, we have a great mobile site, we have an even better mobile app, but it's typically a little more work to place an order on a mobile device and go through a checkout process than it is on desktop. So we expected that it would be the same, or potentially more of these sessions would take place on mobile. Well, we found out it's about 2 times more likely for them to have their sessions on desktop. So that assumption didn't quite check out. We don't collect age demographics for ours in our CRM. So we do collect birth dates, but we don't collect the years. So we didn't have good data on this beforehand. We didn't know, you know, what's the sort of age demographic of someone who places an order manually as opposed to through the website. And what we found using the demographic data that is available in Google Analytics, if you enable it, is that the type of customer that does place an order manually or offline is between the ages of 35, but less likely to be over 65. This is sort of a very interesting thing. It's not super actionable, but sometimes you find these like fun facts. It's very exciting. Another base assumption we have within the sales organization is that one of the reasons that people were placing these orders manually was because they needed more help. And anecdotally, it's true. You know, routinely we have these sales calls that last 30 minutes, 45 minutes. Customer has a very specific need and they really need help walking through the options and making sure that whatever they're ultimately going to purchase fits what they're trying to accomplish. So we assumed that typically those sessions, and I'm not just talking about the session that resulted in the transaction, but all of the user sessions, we expected that there would be less page views involved. It turns out there's more. They spend more time on site. They look at more products. They evaluate their options further. They spend more time per page. And this was really insightful because it shows you that it's not a customer that necessarily needs more help. It's a well-informed customer going into the process. The one thing that did check out is that they do spend quite a bit more than those who place order on the website. So on the next slide, we'll talk about the value we got from this. So one of the immediate pieces of value we got was by synchronizing this information back into Google Analytics, having Google Analytics connected to Google Ads, and having our goals synchronized with Google Ads, those offline transactions and their values now filter back to Google Ads and can be utilized in bidding strategies. So where I mentioned before, when you have a campaign focusing on a high value item, you know, and you didn't get quite the ROAS you were looking for or the CPAs that you were looking for, you could assume, oh, well, you know, there's probably a bunch of offline orders. They're just not represented here. We don't have to do that anymore. Because the data is being synchronized back, we can make those informed decisions. We don't have to make assumptions. We can make those data-driven decisions. Within GA360, one of the most awesome features is the ability to create audiences and then utilize those audiences, not just for analysis and insight, but also to implement in your advertising strategy. And this is one of the things we've done now too, is utilize the audiences that we can create based on these behavior patterns, whether they place an order through our website or whether they place an order over the phone, and create specific campaigns targeting those types of consumers. And then for our sales organization, it's a great opportunity for them to start having the type of understanding of the consumer profile and their behaviors that on the marketing side, when it comes to the orders coming through our website, we've had the whole time. So they were always missing that. Now they can go in there, they can look at that, and they can start to understand their customer, the people that they're serving, even better. So as we proceed to the next slide, we'll get into the bonus round. So this was advertisers talking about cost data too. We will absolutely do that. I'm going to talk about two other data silos that we tackled with InfoTrust over the past couple of years. So let's talk about advertising costs first. All right, getting transaction data is great, but what about cost data? So I'm sure that many of you that use Google Analytics, you use Google Ads, you have them linked together, and you utilize that cost data that's coming from Google Ads into Google Analytics and shows up in some of your acquisition reports, shows up in some of your custom reporting, shows up in your attribution, and hopefully you utilize it very effectively. We certainly do. So, you know, that's available out of the box. But what about the other platforms? So every company is different in terms of what you use, but it's very likely that you're using multiple advertising platforms to acquire customers, bring in orders, so on and so forth. You know, Facebook, Instagram, Bing search engines, you can get cost data from all of them, but they're within their respective platforms. So the data silo. So when you're analyzing the performance of, you know, a Facebook campaign, or let's say it a Bing campaign, this is most similar to the Google Ads product. So you're looking at a Bing campaign, you can't look at that the same way you do the Google one, because the Google one, you can look within analytics and you can see the multiple channel touch points and everything like that. You're limited to what you're being provided by Bing. So siloed data, once again, makes it harder to be as effective a marketer as you'd like. But it turns out there's a solution for this. So proceed to the next slide. Google offers a feature that allows you to import cost data. And hopefully many of you are already doing this, but we weren't until the past year. The beauty of this is that unlike our systems, which are all proprietary, so we had to take on, you know, a pretty significant lift on the engineering side in order to sync the transaction data back. These platforms, you know, they're pretty much standard, they're the same. So we were able to work with InfoTrust extensively on the implementation of this. So they took on the heavy lift and we just got the benefits. So the daily uploads of cost data are now coming from those platforms and they're synchronized back to specific advertising campaigns. Just like the Google Ads data is coming in, we now have that coming in from Bing and other search engines. We have it coming in from our affiliate program. We have it coming in from our comparison shopping engines and social media and all of those other advertising channels we have. And now they are showing up in our attribution reports. They're showing up in our acquisition reports. We can see with all the various touch points that a customer may have before placing a transaction, you know, what is the data-driven value of those touch points and what are our real returns on our ad spend? One of the really key benefits of this project is that we decided to add retroactive data going back a year. So we didn't have to wait for things to start coming in. Once the project was complete, we immediately were able to dive in, have our advertising teams dive in and really pull those insights, pull that analysis. You know, some of those channels that they thought were doing poorly, turns out they were doing much better when you looked at them in a non-siloed fashion. And other ones, not as great, but it allowed them to go in, to optimize, to fine-tune everything. Please, next slide. The implementation value. So as I mentioned, better understanding cross-channel performance in non-siloed view, but this was completed in July of 2020. We have seen tremendous growth. We have scaled up our operations extensively while prioritizing the safety and health of our workforce. But we kind of hit a brick wall where we maximized capacity. And to some degree, that has slowed down advertising for us. Now, we've got great plans in place for 2021 to expand things further. And I fully expect that we will be able to utilize a lot of the insight that we've drawn from this and change our approach even further with how we spend our advertising dollars across the different channels. In the next slide, we'll talk about refunds. So just like you can use measurement protocol to synchronize back transactions that did not take place in your website or Google Analytics and not collect to begin with, you can also use it to sync back refund events. So things like cancellations or returns. That is a separate dimension. So it doesn't overwrite the sales or revenue associated with a specific transaction. It adds another value. So by doing this, we were able to generate more insights on the behavior related to refunds. So, you know, when we look at the performance of an acquisition channel, normally we're just looking at what we call the demand. You know, the orders were placed, what was the value of those? Now we can also look at, like, what was the real revenue associated with this? You know, what was the revenue net of any cancellations or returns? Are there any outliers? Are there things that we should adjust as a marketing organization to make sure that we're getting the most value we possibly can? We can also understand the on-site behavior. So, you know, someone who ends up canceling an order, what sort of things did they do or not do? You know, did they spend some time reading about the availability of the items before placing their order? Did they look into shipping timelines? Did they create an account? Did they use any of the filters to make sure that they found exactly what they were looking for? And we can start to understand better, and we already are, you know, what sort of things are missing or happen that more likely lead to a cancellation, to a return. And also the frequency of replacement order. So, you know, certainly there are situations where someone cancels an order where they found something else and they just canceled the order and placed an order. That's great. That happens all the time. We also have situations where someone buys something, it doesn't quite work out, and they return it, and maybe they have store credit. So obviously, we're incentivized. We want people to continue to place additional orders with us, even if that specific order didn't work out. Now we can see the frequency of that happening, and we can also create audiences and specifically retarget. So, you know, if you have a new customer that you acquired, and for whatever reason, their specific order doesn't work out, whether it's a cancellation or a return, well, we can create an audience for that. And we can try to reach back out to those customers through our various channels, through personalization, through advertising, and bring them back. Hopefully they have a better experience the second time. We can also identify customers that have very high rates of cancellation or returns. It's clearly we're not a good fit for what they're looking for. And we can make sure that we are not overbidding on those types of customers that ultimately are not the type of customer that is a fit for our stores. So On the next slide here, there are a lot of feature extensions that we have in mind that we're hoping to really tackle in 2021. Now that we've started synchronizing some order level data, we're thinking about what more can we synchronize. So what if we could synchronize the net markup associated with that order, the profitability of that order? You know, obviously, we want to grow sales, we want to acquire new customers, but we also want to do so profitably. And right now, we don't have that full insight into which channels are generating the most profit. And with that data, we could obviously do even more in terms of making our marketing as effective as possible. We also have our own internal system through our CRM that scores customers and assigns types to them. And then those scores and those types heavily influence the lifetime value. It's very predictive. I'm sorry, it doesn't influence it, but it's very predictive of the lifetime value. So synchronizing that data back to Google Analytics and utilizing things like audiences will allow us to even better target those customers that ultimately will have great lifetime values, years and years of orders with us, and the type of customers that we really want to bring into our organization. So we're looking even more so this year to utilize these new goals that we create based on the activities and audiences in our A/B testing too. We've done some of this, but in 2021, this is a real opportunity for us that we're going to focus on and trying to do more targeted testing and try to improve the outcomes with these audiences. Next slide, please. So what are the takeaways? What I hope your takeaways are not necessarily how to do this or that you should do exactly what I just said, import your cost data, synchronize orders that you may be taking from a siloed point of sale system or over the phone or anything like that, but more to think about what data do you have that would help you do your job better, that you have siloed. Now you have siloed away from your analytics, your digital analytics, right? And what could linking that together and having that holistic view do in terms of improving your efficacy at acquiring customers or the efficiency of your advertising spend? I mean, these are the things that ultimately drive growth, right? They're the things that make certain competitors within an industry more or less effective, right? And more or less successful. So what is it within your organization that is not connected to the experiences that your visitors, that your customers are having on your website? What are you missing? And is there a path forward to bringing all that data together? And the answer probably is yes, but it's obviously specific to every company and what you're trying to do. So that's it. That's my presentation for today. I sincerely appreciate your attention. I hope this has been useful. I encourage any and all of you to reach out, connect through LinkedIn, and I would be happy to answer any questions that you may have. And I look forward to the rest of the presentations today.